So I'm going to talk about one of my areas of research, which is banking fraud and the technology that's used to prevent it, but also understanding how it actually happens, because unless you understand that, it's not going to be possible to come up with techniques that will actually prevent it effectively. Probably start by looking at how the most common or most sophisticated frauds happen, and that will help us understand about why the banks design the defences the way that they do, and then we can maybe look a bit more about how the defences actually work in a bit more detail. The most problematic situation for bank customers is something called the man in the browser attack. So it's not a very good name. It comes from terminology in banking or computer security more broadly called man in the middle, and this is where the adversary is somewhere between the person who is legitimately doing the transaction and then the person who's receiving the transaction, so in this case the bank. But the reason it's called man in the browser rather than man in the middle is it's not like the adversary is just out on the network somewhere. The adversary has actually put software onto the victim's computer through malware or however, and then that malware is interfering with what the person sees. If we think about this as the victim's web browser, you'd put in the account number you want to send the money to, you'd put in the amount, and then you'd put in a one-time password. How that used to work is that banks would send a sheet of paper with lots of passwords that people typed in. Nowadays, people have got mobile phones, but they type in a one-time password. This looks kind of secure, but the problem is that if there is a man in the browser involved, this is not actually the real banking website. This is just a fake screen that is set up by the malware. What's really happening is that the criminal is putting in the criminal's account number and a much larger amount, and this is the detail that is being sent to the bank. The bank will only accept the transaction if the one-time password is correct, but that's fine because the customer is going to put in the one-time password here, the malware will receive it and then put the one-time password in there, and then the bank will get the transaction. But the bank will see the criminal's transaction, not the one that the customer actually intended. So the customer is logged onto online banking. The details that they type in or something like paying their electricity bill or gas bill, but actually they could be transferring £100,000 to the criminal's account. And because the transaction is actually coming from the victim's own computer and it's coming from their own web browser, albeit a hacked web browser, from the bank's perspective, that's perfectly legitimate. So this was a big problem for the banking industry in lots of countries. So the banks in most of Europe have now moved over to not only having a one-time password, but making that one-time password linked to the transaction. So it's not just authenticating who someone is, it's authenticating the transaction. It's called transaction authentication.
From my experience, we've been using these little devices at home for a long time. I know you've brought a few along.
Yeah.
Are there any places still using this straight one-time password system in the world?
So in general, even though America is quite sophisticated in most circumstances, for banking and banking security, they're quite behind. So in America, it's actually quite unusual to do online banking for moving money around full stop. Checks are still being used, even though in most of Europe they're gone, and in the UK the banks are trying to get rid of them. So they in general don't really have any particularly sophisticated banking security. But in some ways that's actually better for the customer, because the banking laws in the US are very much consumer focused. So essentially if anything goes wrong, the bank will give your money back. Even if the bank believes that you've acted negligently, you've done something that no one could reasonably expect it to do, they're still legally obliged to give most of your money back. And in practice, they'll actually give all of your money back. The Europe and the UK does have better banking technology, but when it goes wrong, often the customer actually pays the cost. So one of the other things I've been doing is talking to regulators and telling them that when they're looking at banking technology and when that banking technology is being used to shift the cost of fraud to the customer, they should look to see if the security technology is actually working properly and whether it's reasonable to make customers liable for fraud when they don't really have any choice about how the system works or how it's designed. Certainly in Europe, the more simplistic systems are either gone or they're going to be eliminated because there's a new European law called the Payment Services Directive 2, which actually mandates the more secure transaction authentication. However, it, like most laws, doesn't actually say the technical details about how things are going to work. And that's probably good because politicians are not very good in developing technology. It just says what criteria the system should meet. And so there's a huge diversity across all of Europe and even within countries as to how these technologies work. And in terms of cryptography, they're all basically okay. They might not use the most modern cryptography. So for example, banking systems often use DES, the data encryption standard, rather than the more modern AES encryption block cipher. But that's essentially irrelevant for most purposes. Where they do vary a lot is in the way that they work and the way that people interact with them. And that actually causes a huge difference in terms of their security. Because if someone is confused about how they work, then they could be quite easily tricked into doing something wrong. And we've seen that criminals actually are doing that. So one traditional trick by criminals is, assuming the technology works, what they will say is they'll take over your web browser and then they'll tell you some story. And the story normally goes along the lines of, there's been some error, money has appeared in your account, and your account is going to be locked until you send this money back to the legitimate owner. And if you log on to your online banking and look at your statement, then this fake transaction will be there, your balance will be far larger than it normally will be, and there will be instructions about transferring this money back to the right person. But actually, that's all fake. The money has not appeared in your account, and the so-called legitimate owner of the money is actually the criminal's account. So you'll use one of these devices to authorize a transaction to move this money, but actually you're sending your own money to the criminals, and it could be a long time before you notice that this has been going on. And that sort of scam works because people are too distracted by trying to make the technology work in any way whatsoever that they don't actually have the time to think about whether they really should be using this technology to do that transaction. So essentially, the more obvious and the easier you make the technology, the less likely it is that criminals are going to be able to get people to act in insecure ways.
It seems to me that's kind of a phishing attack mixed with malware. So what's going on with the devices themselves? Why have they had to resort to that?
Yeah, so there's three broad categories. So there's the devices that you put your card into, like this one. These are very common in the UK. This isn't a UK device, this is from the Netherlands. It's got a keypad, it's got a few buttons, and it's got a card that goes into it. Really, the device is not doing very much in this case. All the work is actually being done by the card, and that's why people can actually use someone else's device. In the UK, even a device from a different bank, and it will still work, provided they're using their card. But because it's using a card, it's got some limitations. So the first one, it's got to be actually quite big and chunky, because it's got to be large enough to have batteries that powers the card, and it's got to be large enough to physically have the card inside it. And that's one reason they're unpopular. So the alternative is a device like this. So this has still got a keypad. It's much smaller, much thinner, smaller batteries, and it can do that because there's no card that needs to be put into it. Some customers like this, but the downside is that this device is now linked to you. So this is the one that's linked to your account. So it's not like you can borrow someone else's device. It's not like you can have one device at home and one device at work, like you can with the card reader devices like these. But with both of these devices, there's got to be some way for linking the password that it generates to the transaction details. And the way that this works is you type in something like either the account number you're sending the money to or the last four digits of the account you're sending the money to. And that's a bit inconvenient, particularly if you have to do it a lot. So that's why there's other devices. This has a little camera on the back. you use that camera to scan a 2D barcode that the bank shows you, and that's much, much easier for customers to use. And it means that you're not just authorizing the last four digits of the account number, the bank can actually send a lot more details about the transaction. So firstly, that reduces the amount of effort that the customer needs to go to, because they just scan something rather than type something. And also it gives them more details, which hopefully gives them a better chance at trying to spot whether there's one of these scams at work. Then we've got yet another one. This one also has a PIN. With all of these devices, you want to check firstly whether the transaction has been authorized, but also whether the right customer is doing the transaction. And the traditional way to do that is two factors. So something the customer has and something they know. So for the card reader devices, like this one, it's do they actually have the card and do they know the PIN? It's a four-digit PIN. This has got a four-digit PIN as well. This, you can have a PIN. This one doesn't, but the way that the banks use that is that they ask the customer to enter a password into the website. But the password has got to be much longer than a four-digit PIN, because when you're typing a password into a website, a criminal can try lots and lots and lots of passwords. But with all of these devices, where you type a PIN into it, the device itself actually checks that the PIN has not been entered too many times. So in the case of the card reader, card has got a secure counter on it, and then once that goes above 3, the card locks out. And it's similar with these two devices. Once the PIN has been entered too many times in these devices, they lock and you've got to talk to the bank to unlock them again.
The Torpic botnet was the first one, or one of the first at least, introducing the domain generation algorithms in order to find the domain where they would have found the command and control server in a dynamical way during the infection. But what has been done by researchers in 2009